Yeah, I'm sorry. I just forgot to record the session. So friends, you know, we have three excellent speakers taking up the Galaxy India project, and as well as, you know, taking the hands-on sessions for Galaxy. So the very first speaker is Kiran K. Telukunta, who also runs a not-for-profit India youth organization. He's also associated with TMS, but is currently as an information specialist and information scientist based in Germany. He has a very interesting profile. He learned German at a very young age. He moved to Germany. He was piggybacking between Belgium and Germany. And he obtained his PhD from Albert Ludwig University in 2018. He had a math background, and then he has taken up a PhD in pharmacological bioinformatics, which is absolutely a kind of a unique blend. And then he has been associated with Galaxy over the last 6 years. And he has been a solution architect and managing, you know, the cloud-based services over the years. And is an excellent, you know, speaker and wonderful developer of Galaxy-based tools. So Kiran is followed by Sangram Keshari Sahu, who is a bioinformatics architect at Lifebit. He worked for various companies, including the very famous BioNivid, as a genomics data scientist. He was a DBT junior research fellow at ICER Mohali. He worked for Pondy University. In fact, he did his master's in bioinformatics from Pondicherry University in 2017. Sangram also has developed a number of R Shiny based apps, taking up, you know, the Galaxy based bioinformatics. And the third speaker is Harpreet Singh, who is going to give probably a demo today if he has time. Otherwise, he'll take up the sessions on Sunday, a brief session. So don't worry, we'll not take much of his time, much of your time on Sunday. So Harpreet Singh is the head of the department and a professor at Hansraj Mahila Vidyalaya. Is also the finance secretary of BioClues and the secretary of Asia Pacific Bioinformatics Network. He has developed wonderful plant-based bioinformatics tools where he has worked on stress-related things. And he has been a very popular figure, not just in Hansraj Mahila Vidyalaya, but all over Punjab and North India, and as well as all over India, because he has mentored over several bioinformatics graduate students. And ever since he has taken up a position in BioClues in 2017, our BioClues has steadfastly grown towards, you know, success. So these three wonderful scientists will take you towards, you know, the Galaxy. Now it is time you take these wonderful sessions, ask questions, take you know, some of the notes. So please don't worry, you know, all the talks will be recorded, but you know, it's high time, you know, you make this, you know, more interactive, please. You know, this is a humble session. So thank you so much, you know, for all of your times. So over to you, Kiran. Yeah, please. Thank you.
Great. Thank you, Prashant, for a nice introduction. Okay, I'll try to share my thing.
So Kiran, I'm just putting off from Prash account, so I'll be able to chat if you have any questions. So thank you. I'm still recording.
Yeah. And can you allow the sharing from the admin, please?
Yeah, please. Yeah, 1 minute. 1 minute.
Yeah.
I'm just making you host. I hope now that would allow me to still record, right?
Yes, but I think then I will be monitoring if it is getting recorded or not. Probably you will not be able to see anymore if it is getting recorded, but it's okay. You can do that.
Yeah. Yes. Yeah.
Okay. Great. Thank you. Okay, thank you very much. And I will try to. So good afternoon or good evening to everyone. It was a nice pleasant talk what we had before from NS sir. It's a very like completely joyful kind of a talk I was having actually. So my idea will be a bit kind of different emotion for you all. So let's see. So basically this is about Galaxy framework. Would like to introduce what is Galaxy framework, and also you would also have a kind of session, hands-on session, couple of hands-on session. Would be great if you all have your PCs or computers or laptops in front of you at the later stage, and you can do simultaneously when we try to do some hands-on session. Okay, so let's start. So I would like to start with the present scenario where right now thing is happening. I mean, everybody knows it's a COVID season, COVID thing is going on. And basically we want to actually knock down the COVID. So that's a definitely a fiery scenario what we have. We are seeing a lot of everything, all the bad things, wrong things for humanity, everything is going on. So basically now there is a COVID scenario where a natural science can address this issue. Will the galaxy help us? So if so, how? Before going that, I want to actually, as I said, I want to take you to kind of a different emotion or different kind of direction. I'll try to frighten you all. Let's see how far I can do that. But then I'll try to give also some kind of a solution for that. So that's the scenario. So yeah, for basically when we want to try to solve the problem of, let's say, COVID problem to find some vaccine or so find some drug, it's basically a lot of research has to be done. So mainly, let's say these three areas, which can be kind of a research areas. Sorry, is it audible enough? Is it something stuck up?
Yes, Kiran, we can hear, at least I can hear you.
Okay, fine. Yeah, I'll keep on. So basically, it can be segregated into three kinds of research. One, genomics, chemoinformatics, proteomics. The idea in this talk is not to in detail explain all these things, and also not like going into deep analysis of those things, but to actually show you how much it takes, like what kind of things are there to do all this kind, all these areas of research. So nothing is a kind of a kind of order of things right now with genomics or chemoinformatics or proteomics. They can go in simultaneously also, but they can interdisciplinary exchange their knowledge. But then we will try to see what are the things, or let's say, how are the areas what we try to address when we try to solve the problem of COVID. So if we are going in the direction of genomics, as you already seen yesterday, a nice presentation and talk, even in a hands-on thing, what Prash explained about a lot of these areas. So in genomics, it would be like pre-processing the raw data. So we have to get the data and then process it. And this pre-processed data is assembled for the SARS-CoV-2 genome. And then estimation of timing, like finding the ancestor of the COVID genome and where it arised, and trying to understand it, its evolutionary analysis of variation within individual isolates. So as you generate a lot of sequences and similar sequences, so we need to understand the variation of different sequences. I know some people could probably not understand everything. Even I wouldn't be able to completely understand because there are some different areas. So it's completely fine. I will still try to frighten you. So just try to go understand the things, what the areas are there. So analysis of spike protein with the substitutions, and analysis of recombination and selection, where recombining all the spike protein and other analysis done are being combined together and deploying them for the evolutionary analysis. So these are the kind of steps involved. A bit of detail, let's go for into this. So in terms of pre-processing, you would require a raw data. And those raw data, as is explained yesterday by Prashant also, you will get mostly popular ones are Illumina and Oxford Nanopore. So let's try to see a couple of them. I just want to have a show view of those things for you. So this is like kind of first reads which came out from the Wuhan University, and they were supplied for the to the Illumina from the Illumina to the NCBI. So in similar way, there are some reads. And of course, there are several reads, but I just took some of them here. And of course, Oxford Nanopore reads, which are like a bit huge sequences compared to the NCBI sequences. So these are the sequences must you get. And these has to be kind of need to be more of pre-processed. So that's a kind of a initial step of raw data. This is a kind of first pre-processing step. So for this pre-processing step, what kind of tools could be useful? So the tools such as SRA tools. So it's a very useful toolkit. It's a kind of standard development kit produced by NCBI. It's basically used for the collection of tools and libraries, like for the International Nucleotide Scientific Development Community Consortium. So they use this tool and actually developed by them. So this is a kind of tools, once you install, there are several tools within this. You can use all those tools. And this will be useful, as I said, like once the raw reads are there, those can be processed. So for that, SRA tools can be used. FastQC, you have seen yesterday also kind of some hands-on on this. So FastQC will try to give a quality control checks of the sequence, what we have taken. You already seen a kind of an experience how to install, or let's say how to use it yesterday. So there are some commands where you can actually install those commands. And yeah, it can be installed in various operating systems, that's possible. But yeah, it's just shown, which is like an installation in Ubuntu Linux kind of an environment. So this also would be kind of useful tool. Another tool is MultiQC. It's basically kind of aggregating all the results produced by various pre-processing raw read tools, like such as SRA tool or other tools also. When the data is produced, this data is basically aggregated as a kind of a form of results and then shown in a better viewable format. And so this MultiQC can also be used. So this is also a very useful Python tool, which can be installed with Conda and other tools. So of course it can be installation will be various things. So anyway, for the MultiQC would be useful in that type of analysis, or let's say aggregating the results. FastP. So FastP is more about, it is making a consolidation of the quality format, what we got. These will be processed again. And this tool is developed mainly in the based on C++ language. And it is a very high performance tool, which can actually do with several sequences at a time. So this is a very nice feature and also can be used in the Linux environment or Bioconda. So that also is a kind of very useful tool. Nanoplot, this is another tool. Once you have kind of sequencing data, you want to put all the alignments and then view this data in a much better way, in a kind of read length format, where you want to see the average read density and such a kind of thing. So in this way, this could be useful with comparison between read lengths and average density. So that's how the nanoplot can be useful. That's also can be installed and used. Let's go for the next more tools. So for pre-processing, more tools would be like PWSA is another software package. It's a kind of complete package, has a kind of three different tools. One BWMM is a very recent one, which does a much better computation in divergent sequences. So this can be used for the reference genome. I think you have learned about reference genome yesterday. So the basically to tackle with the reference genome, even if that's not the de novo tool, also can be the results of de novo method also can be combined with this. So that's a possibility with this tool. And another one is Picard. It's a basically the tool which can access from the BOM format and also works with the NGS data. So yeah, this is a tool for the high throughput screening sequences. So Yeah, for this kind of data, the Picard can be used, which completely converts the bound format to other formats, useful format. So in that way, Picard can be used. SAMTools also, it's a, again, a sequence alignment tool, and it has a group of tools, around 14 to 15 tools, as far as I remember. And they are also, it converts BAMP format and also the CRAMP format. So some institutes use in a different CRAMP formats. So that also it can address. So in that way, the SAMTools can be used. So once the pre-processing done, then you want to assemble that, all the things. So you want to assemble the, whatever the pre-processing of the raw data we have done. This can be done with Unicycler. It's a pipeline which can develop a kind of pipeline with a bacterial genome, especially used for the bacterial genomes. Of course, it can be applied to other areas, but especially developed for the bacterial genomes. And the SPADES is another tool. It's basically an algorithm. So designed for multi-cells bacterial datasets, it has three different algorithms. And one can choose which you want to select. And then based on that, you can actually do better assembling of the sequences what we had in the raw phase. After this, you want to do a bandage. This is much more better one for the de novo genome assemblies for the interactive visualization. So it will be kind of interactive visualization of the sequences. Kind of it does a bandage of all the sequence and joins them. So this will open up in a better viewable way. Here we can recognize more detailed structure of the sequence. So in that way, bandage will be useful. That's for the assembly. And then let's go for the estimation of time. It's about estimating the time of, let's say, more common ancestors. So once we want to actually address the COVID species or the COVID virus, we want to also understand from where it ever evolved. So there comes a lot of tools which are basically related to phylogeny tree. So before that, we have to take the data from the NCBI. So NCBI download kind of another tool which can be used here, which can easily get the data from NCBI and then also map it to the GenBank or RIF sequences. So again, the Picard will be useful here. Now, as you have multiple sequence, now it's time for maybe you want to do multiple sequence alignment. So MUFT is a very good algorithm. Of course, there are many other tools. MUFT is basically with the long sequences and more number of data, it can handle much better. Recent times, since the seventh version, it is much more improved version. So this is also very useful tool in terms of building the phylogeny tree. So, and then comes the fast tree. So you actually seen yesterday just a couple of tools. I'm trying to brush through all the tools. I know it's a bit too much, but please hold on. So the fast tree is infers approximately maximum likelihood of phylogeny tree. So it tries to get the likelihood of the tree. So it's approximate with the probability analysis. And then gets construct the phylogeny tree for the alignments also of nucleotide and also protein sequences. So surely here it will be useful into understanding the phylogeny tree. And then afterwards, analysis of variation within individual isolates. Again, here we can use the BWA SAM tools, which we've seen before, because as they have a group of tools, there's another tool which is LowFreq, is a fast and sensitive variant caller. This is basically more useful in SNVs, and it also useful to detect the insert and deletions from the NGS sequences data. So this is ideal tool in those scenarios. It's also again possible to install in binary package, can be installed in the Linux environment. And comes the SNPFE tool. It's a variant annotation tool. You've been learning about the annotation and also curation thing. So here it's basically it's more deals about the annotation and the prediction of it. It annotates and also predicts the genetic variants. So in this way, you can actually try to know the variants, which is what is important in this step, analysis of variation. So this tool also does that. So yeah, this can, it's a one of the tool and a kind of a popular tool, which is from the Microsoft tool. So yeah, they are, Microsoft Bioinformatics also have lots kind of tools gathering. So it is part of that one. And PoreChop, it's basically chops of the adapters and also in the Oxford nanopore reads. So removing the adapters from the Oxford nanopore reads, this works much better. And chopping the ends. So in that way, so as the image shows, so it's very useful in removing the adapters, adapters at the end of reads, and they can be trimmed off. And comes the fit long. So this is basically filtering long sequences, long reads, so that you can have what is more important area you want to cover. So in this way, fit long will be a very useful tool. This will try to filter sequences what we require, and then for that sequence, that part of sequence, we can actually search in the rich sequences in other areas. So in that way, fitlong can be used. Minimap is a versatile sequence alignment program. Again, it's more of useful for the DNA or the mRNA sequences. Again, for the against to the reference database. Bounty is another tool. It's an ultra fast memory efficient tool in terms of aligning sequence reads. Even it handles long reference sequences. This is more useful in terms of variation here when the sequences are considered to be in with the variation of isolates. So this works much better in the Bounty. And of course, the MAFTI again comes in to find out the multiple alignment of to find the spike protein. And another one is EMBOSS. Contains a wide array of general purpose bioinformatic tools. It's a kind of combination of several tools, EMBOSS again. So there are several tools combined with the EMBOSS. So this is also useful in analysis of spike protein, the protein which basically we want to knock out in the COVID virus. So that's basically to find out, and then in that way we can do the analysis of the spike protein substitutions. Here again, after doing that, we want to combine all the sequences. Let's say the sequence is what we have. And again, try to do multiple sequence alignment. Also with HIFI, this is more useful in genetic sequence techniques to find the phylogenetics, molecular evolution and machine learning. FastTree, which is like finds the maximum likelihood of the phylogenetic tree. And then we've seen this in the MCR step where the phylogeny was constructed. Again, it's useful here. And after this genomics thing comes the another area, which is like cheminformatics. In this, whereas we have steps such as virtual screening, in the virtual screening of the proteins, what we have from the SARS-CoV-2 and preparation it for the docking. So we have to prepare all the proteins, what we have for the docking, so that it can be useful to have a one target and then find the compounds which are docking to the target. So we will try to do that one in this step. And active site preparation, as Nenasar was explaining about the cheminformatics lot. And so docking also comes into this area. So first we try to do docking. There are several methods of docking. I'm not going in detail into that. There are more tools in as I explained in the first genomics in all of these steps, you have again many several tools in virtual screening, preparation, active site, and docking. After docking, you want to score them and then rank the compounds. And from several million compounds, or let's say fragments also, you want to group them and then make a selection of compounds, maybe around 500 or something like 250 compounds, where you want to do kind of synthesis. And that synthesis can be used for the deployment to understand how they work. So that could be a kind of deployment step. So this is like more of cheminformatics area where the research can happen for the SARS-CoV-2. And comes, we also want to actually examine the proteins in different areas, the proteomics in COVID-19 lung tissues. This, for all these things, lung tissues kind of research has happened. So the lung tissues data can also be used. And for the human protein-protein interaction, that will be an information, important information, how this protein, where it is getting interacted. And so that is also kind of a research area where you want to do get the protein and interaction with certain proteins where it is getting interacted. Infected cell culture samples you want to take, deep proteomic analysis of infected vero cell. Gargling samples are also useful. These were also done research in this area. Swab samples, as you all know, that were taken and the research done with the infected versus non-infected. Respiratory tract samples, bronchoalveolar lavage of patients. This is given to the patients and then the obtained solution is also used for the research. Nasopharyngeal swab samples, also again infected versus non-infected areas. So here again, you will try to compare both the proteomics areas. So again, a lot of analysis will be done in the area of proteomics. Another is metaproteomics analysis. This is for the respiratory tract samples of patients. So all these are the steps which actually go under in lot of this COVID analysis. I hope I was able to frighten you. So then what is it, the point? Here, so many tools are there, so many steps are there. Is everything, well, yeah, there's a question, did you analyze that, Kiran? No, this is a it's a completely analyzed with a large group of community, which was done by the Galaxy community. So that is what I'm trying to show here. So these are all the things which are done by the Galaxy community. If you want to involve in all these areas, you can, as I said, you see all the links for each step. For each link you go, you will have a kind of area where you want to go in detail and where you want to get involved. So many areas are there where you can do. You can say, yes, your method is wrong, I will do. So, but how do we do? So what's the solution for so many tools and how do I actually have all these things? And then I contribute. Then comes our solution. Is basically about the introducing the Galaxy analysis. So now I try to do for the solution, but before that I will just stop. If you have any questions, a couple of minutes. If you have any questions, you can ask. Okay, doesn't it be? So yeah, as I said. Yeah, please go on.
You said that the phylogenetic tree. I want to know that what we actually learn from a plotting a phylogenetic tree. And then can you explain a little bit more about it?
As I said, definitely I haven't done the phylogenetic this area, but I've done the phylogenetic for this different antibiotic. So natural compound, which is Tryptome DB, where I can say in. But anyway, it's more of first you have a kind of compounds and then also you gather those things. But here in this thing, FastTree is a tool which used. Probably this could be a tool for you. You can work on this. You can use this one for the phylogenetry. But to display, again, it depends on what kind of thing you have, like what you want to display in what way. So that can be useful. Of course, before doing that, you want to do alignment, and then you can have better tree structure. So that will be very useful. One example would be a kind of Streptome DB, which I did. So in there, you can see Streptome DB. Maybe I can show it later because once I go there, it's a bit longer thing again.
Hi, Kiran. Kiran, I have a question. I have a question about the proteomics part. So you've shown all these in analysis, which was done on the COVID SARS related research. So yes. Was Galaxy framework used in any of these the studies, or you were just talking about the standard proteomics tools and software that was used?
So everything which I showed till now was completely done in the Galaxy. So all the links we will redirect.
Okay.
Everything is there. So
are you gonna discuss these some of these studies?
Surely not. This is definitely not part of this talk, because each area, if you start discussing, will take a couple of hours and here, however, and also probably everything I will not be able to go also in details. So very few areas I covered. And so it's basically I was trying to show up what are the areas it is trying to cover. So that's the thing. Yeah. But of course, I can guide you where the things are there.
Okay. Oh, certainly. Okay. Great.
Yeah. There's another question from Ranjan. You have shown Galaxy India in your presentation. Is it something different server like Galaxy Europe and Galaxy Australia? I'll come to that point later in this presentation. We have something about it. So I'll come to that and address that question. So I go further then. So now I try to show the Galaxy kind of brief introduction, how it is. So this is part of the Galaxy training network. So this is the presentation you can always access. I will give you the links where you can get to all these things. So first we will try to see what is Galaxy. So Galaxy is basically a data intensive analysis for everyone. It has like completely versatile. So anybody, it can accept many kind of formats and many kind of areas, scenarios. And it can produce, it can gives an option of producing, reproducing workflows. We'll come to that workflows. It's a completely web platform. So you don't need to install anything. If you have a browser, you're ready to go. So it could be probably possible from the mobile, but yeah, you will be very slow in doing that. So it's better maybe on the desktop and mobile. So basically it's completely on the web. So you do everything on the web platform. And it's completely open source and under academic free license. So if you adhere to the academic free license and then citation, that's what the Galaxy community expects from the users. So it's a completely open source tool. It's basically developed in the Penn State Johns Hopkins University and Cleveland. These are the universities which contributed in the start, and gradually it spread throughout the world, and Europe became a lot more into this. So yeah, it expanded to many areas since last 12 years, more than a decade. Core values about the Galaxy. It's basically focuses on three areas: accessibility, reproducibility, and transparency. So accessibility, that every user should be able to access without even any programming experience. So you don't need to have any programming experience to use it. You can upload the data if you have the data, or you can use the data which is already available in free resources or the public resources. You can run with all the complex tools what you have, with the workflows what already existing, but you can create your own workflows or the pipelines. Let's say yesterday you learned it as a pipelines or the workflows here, and visualize them also. And reproducibility, that's one of the important things. As of now, if you see the main one of the area which was Galaxy was trying to address was, and throughout world, many departments in the natural science exist. So each department, it could be as an NSR was saying, all the different areas like physics, chemistry, mathematics, all kind of departments come. So every kind of department is there, and each department is, it's not that easy to communicate with each other department. And so they develop their own tools. They have several tools, and it could be possible that the tools were developed kind of a duplicity. So there are few departments who would have developed same tool, and then it was kind of duplicity also. So this is a kind of a area where Galaxy tried to address. So whatever tool is developed, it can be used, and the analysis is done, can be reproducible by other department, like other resource or the other user. So that's the area what Galaxy tries to address. It's main, one of the feature is reproducibility. So you can actually, the user who has done the first workflow can publish their complete thing, and then it can be reproduced. Transparent. It's completely whatever done, the research are completely transparent in the Galaxy. So there are many public workflows and analysis which can be accessed. There are many online methods, and also Galaxy is completely available online. So it can be kind of cited also. So if you see, come to the point of citations. So there are already more than 11,000 citations with the help of Galaxy. And there are almost, as the tools which I showed were very few, probably I showed only 20 to 30 or 40 tools maybe. And there are almost like more than 8,000 tools which are kind of validated tools which can be used. So all these tools are available to anybody who wants to use. As I said, like there are more than 11,000 citations with the help of all these tools and that structure that been happening. And there are more than 170 public Galaxy servers. So when I say public Galaxy servers, this could be kind of focused in different areas. they are not. So if you see that 8,000 tools, maybe in that 170 public servers, those 8,000 tools would be there, but not all. So in one public server, you might get some 100 tools, another 200 tools, or maybe combination of this, or maybe 500 tools in that way. So these 170 public servers will try to have those all the 8,000 tools. So, and of course, there are also 130 public servers which are non-public. Among them, among these 170, they are not available to others. And domain specific, which are, as I said, like a very group of tools will be there, very specific group of tools, like maybe informatics or proteomics in that area and focusing in some areas. So those Galaxy servers can be used for those purposes. So now we come to the point, user interface. How does it look? It looks something like this. So it has kind of a three panes, one in the left, tools pane, and the middle pane is the main pane, and the right side is the history pane. You see all the tools in the left side, they are getting listed. You will have a kind of a hands-on where you will see a bit more kind of a feel. And then the right side, you have history. So whatever you do, the completely things are getting displayed on the right side, and the output also getting displayed. And if you want to configure each tool, kind of changing the parameters, all those things can be done in the main area. So in this way, the three division works. So another menu, so that is in the top menu. There are the top menu. In this, you have analyze data, which was the screen which you saw earlier in the previous slide, this one. And if you go to workflow, which you also will see today, and then we'll explain at that point of time how that workflow works, and the visualize, where you will see the visualizations of the interactive environment. So some tools give an output of visualization, so it's more focused to exhibit the data output in a much visual scenario. And share the data. So all the libraries, histories, workflows, whatever you have done, the research or the workflows, the steps involved, all these things can be shared. That's basically the shared aspect. Help, where you have kind of a forum. Also you have a wiki and a kind of interactive tools, which will help you to understand where the tabs and then where we have to, how to use the interface. So such kind of tools are also there. User, where you here you log in and you will also save your preferences, your data sets and your pages, which are exclusive to you, which are not visible to others. So you can decide which to make public and which not. That was top menu, and comes to the tools. So this is how a tool. So here we are trying to use a tool called join. So once you type join tool, that will get displayed somehow like this. Although this image is a kind of old image in interface, but it will be kind of similar method in the new interface also. So that's how you will see a kind of join tool. Once you click in the middle pane, you will see join, and then with exons and SNPs are getting joined, and what the minimum base pairs of overlap you want to set, and all such kind of parameters can be done.
Yes, possible, you can zoom this screen.
Sure.
Hardly I can read anything. Okay. I don't know if it is possible.
Okay. Sure. I'll try. Okay. Doesn't look like that because that's an image. I'm sorry, I will not be able to do that image. The text is happening, but not that one. It's already 500. Okay, I can put this link in the chat so you can also see.
No issue.
Yeah. I kept the link in the chat so you can actually have it there. So yeah, tool search help in that way, the crowd toolbox. And this is a tool interface. This is what we see. You can put data sets, parameters, and the citations are available here. And the execute button, once you have, and it is executed as a job, and which will produce an output data set in the history. The new tools versions here, you can also see the versions, and also old ones. You can also use multiple version tools also. That's also a possibility. And comes to toolshed. Toolshed is the one which I before said there are 8,000 tools. Right now it is showing here 6,000. It's an old image, but right now this is more than 8,000 tools. Unfortunately, I can't magnify this. Yes. Yeah, so here it's a free app store. So all the tools here, you can search and then look for a tool. You can type in a kind of like SNP or protein or docking, any kind of such kind of keywords. And then you will see what are the tools or would be useful for that kind of scenario. So you can easily find out the tool which you want. And depending on where you are, you can try to use in your Galaxy. When I say depending on where you are, I will try to explain that in the later part. So yeah, it's possible to get the tool. So here, this is how the history looks like. So once you generate, execute, then the history will show all these things. Anyway, also in the hands-on, hopefully you will see these things. I understand that right now it's very small, but you'll also see in the hands-on. So here in the right side, you see in the history, all the data gets generated, all the steps can be visible. Location of analysis can be seen, collect of all the data set that's produced by the tools, all the operations performed. For each data set, Galaxy can, it's a kind of reproducibility is the thing basically. And here this history complete thing can be reproduced and also can be exported or let's say can be shared with some other persons or with the publicly. Here, name, format, size, creation time, data type specific, metadata, all these kind of information will be available. Tool ID, which from the tool shared, version, input parameters, standard output. So if you get some error, a kind of error in viewing is also possible. And if the step in the sense, each step here, if you see the 2, 3, 4, 5 are the kind of jobs, you can always see in what state they are, like waiting, running, success, or failed. You can also hide some of these steps. You can delete those steps and also purge them. Purge in the sense you can just completely remove from the history and then it will still be there. So multiple histories. So if you're doing multiple different analysis, that is also possible. So you can maintain multiple histories, just not one. Each history should corrupt like for different analysis. That's how you can do. It's better to give a meaningful name for each history so that you can recognize. And in the history options menu, you will see options such as history actions, copying, sharing them and publish, showing the structure of the history, extract the workflow to share, set permissions, make it private. And if you're running some jobs, you can pause the jobs also, and the data set actions such as copying them, expanding the data sets, hiding them, deleting and purging. So you can also download the citations related to that. So this you obtain in the history pane. Once you click is the settings option, settings button. You will see all these options. So loading data. So we can do many types of loading data. Extensive methods are shown in this link, but I just give a short introduction for that. So you can copy paste the data. You just don't need to consider like what kind of data you have. You just paste your data. Most of the formats of data, the Galaxy by itself recognizes that. You can upload the files. If you have a couple of files in that way, you can do. You can upload the data if it is existing in somewhere in internet, that URL can be given. You can also give online databases links such as UCSC, BioMart, ENCODE. So these are kind of two databases which are already connected. And import from shared data libraries, like such as histories and pages, that's also possible. If you have a huge data and huge number of files in such way, you can also use the FTP method where you can connect and then completely upload the data. So all this kind of possible importing data are possible. So what kind of data types are there? So yeah, usually the data type, the user no need to take care of it. When you upload the data, by default, the Galaxy tries to recognize that, but in some cases it doesn't. So you should then manually set it. You can also manually change them. While uploading the data sets, its data type can be either automatically detected as user or by the user, that's how it is. And data sets produced by tool have their data type. So each data type, it can be like a PNG format output, or it can be a kind of FASTA file, or it can be a kind of JPEG image file, or it can be some PDF, or it can be a complete any graphical thing, CSV files. So all those can be output data types. So attributes can be edited in if something was not wrongly mapped. And you can also convert. There are many converting tools. So you can use those converting tools once you have certain kind of format. And the different data sets. So you also want to actually do the reference data sets. Yesterday you were seeing the HD38, the human genome thing. So that's along with that, there are many other reference data sets available. So you can use, and some other, if the reference data you own have, that is also possible, but you have to kind of adapt the Galaxy for it. So that's also possible. If it is getting kind of standardized, it will be, if you submit it to the genome Galaxy community, they would accept. And then if they accept, then it can also be put into the reference data sets. That's also a possibility. So that those things can be done by the admin. So this is the kind of first kind of overview of the Galaxy. So this is what how it looks like. As of now, you've just seen how it looks like. It would be good probably if you have a kind of hands-on session. Now, Sangram will give a hands-on session for that. But before that, you can give any questions. If you have any questions, you can go on with your questions. Meanwhile, Sangram will take over them for the hands-on session. So Sangram, are you?
I have one question. Yeah.
Yeah, please, sir.
Kiran, yeah.
Yeah.
The question is, writing your own code for an existing problem and then uploading it in Galaxy can result in a publication?
Yes, it will definitely result in a publication, but uploading in Galaxy is a kind of thing. If you have your own instance of Galaxy, then of course you don't have to take any permission and then you do it by your thing. Okay. But if you want to upload into public thing, then they have kind of set of standards, which if it satisfies, then they will take it.
Okay, thanks a lot. Yeah.
Yes, and of course, as I said, that once you have a tool, it can be kind of cited and it's kind of a publication can be done.
Right, okay, thank you. Yeah.
Yes.
Okay, I want to ask something.
Yeah.
That we are using the first QC or SAM tool or BAM tool in Galaxy. And yesterday we also used in the terminal the SAM tool or the first QC tool. So what is the difference of using and when to use or is any, which is more advantageous, running the Galaxy, the first QC tool in Galaxy or running in the local computer in terminal?
Sure, I think I would leave this answer to yourself because you have actually Sangram's session right now. So you will have a fast QC. Maybe you do that. You also did the yesterday. So you will get by yourself which one you want to do. However, it's more about specific where you want to use it. So sometimes both could be scenarios. Sometimes you want to use the Galaxy. Sometimes you want to use the terminal. But you will figure it out maybe after the Sangram's hands-on session.
Okay. Hello.
Yes, please go on, Ashok.
So I would want to ask, because I am doing a lot of molecular dynamic simulation data.
Yeah.
So they have this coordinate information. There's a, like if you're running 1 millisecond simulations, so we have nearby 2-3 GB data related to these coordinates. We consider if it is a 100 atom molecule, so 100 into that 100 frames. So is there any application or apps so that you can understand the Galaxy and these data can be automatically analyzed and used for machine learning? Model can be fed for machine learning or something like that? They yes. have some interface or something like?
Yes, actually for both the areas, a kind of a different addressing system is there, but you can also both combine. So you were saying two things, molecular dynamics, another thing is a machine learning. You can combine both also. For the molecular dynamics right now, it's the molecular dynamics is more about kind of very high intense hardware infrastructure, what you need. And at that point of time, it's like the Gromax is one of the thing is getting involved into the Galaxy. So that's there are some tools for related to the Gromax and there are other tools also. So there are specifically for these things. And also for the machine learning, also there are tools specifically doing that. If you can figure it out, which tools you want to combine them, and then you can use in that way, it's also a possibility.
So, okay, thank you. Thank you, I'll cost you.
Yeah.
Any more questions? Yeah.
So you can take the share. So do you want to already share? your screen?
Yeah, I can share my screen.
Yes.
Give me a second.
Okay. I'll just stop my share. Probably you will have your own share. That would be easier.
Yeah, sure. Yeah. Can you hear me?
Yes.
Okay, cool. Okay, 1 second. Let me get set up this thing. Can you see the slides, Kiran? Can you confirm, please?
Yes, yeah. Meanwhile, okay. All of you can, go on, Singer. Yeah, he will guide you.
Okay, I'll just drag this one here. So it's easy for me to control. Okay, good evening, good afternoon, like from wherever you guys are. And thank you to Kiran, to give this a real nice introduction. So whatever Kiran just shown with the slides, we're gonna go through all of them in real hands-on time, right? So Kiran already shown you like how Galaxy looks like and what are different components of it and how basically you navigate through it to do your own analysis, right? And right now we're gonna do this on a basically hands-on, like I'm gonna show you how to do these things and parallelly you can do on your own laptops. So for that, primarily, what do we need to do? We need to go to the like one of the Galaxy instances, right? So we're gonna use the Galaxy U site for today's purpose. So may I request you everyone to go to galaxy.eu and log in to one of your account. Okay, if you don't have an account, not worry, like it should be a pretty quick job. So let me show you that as well. Let me log out from my current thing. Okay, so here, like if you don't have already an account in your galaxy.eu, you can register from here, right? Like you just need to provide your email ID and you need to provide some password and you need to confirm your public ID. Then you should receive an email. And that's it. That's all you need to log into this account, right? So I can give you 2 minutes. Like if you have any questions about the login, you can ask me. Otherwise, please log in to the Galaxy Europe instance. Let me share this link with you. Okay. So yeah, if you're having any trouble, like let me know, because this is gonna be an interactive session, right? Because by just seeing, it's not gonna help much, basically. And you will enjoy it for sure. Like once you start using the Galaxy, we will have a great session today. So I request you to log in and do the hands-on session. Once you log in, can you please confirm on the chat or by some other medium or coming into mic or something like this?
Yeah, that would be great. If you can inform on the chat, then we know how many people are ready with the login.
Exactly. So once you go to this site, which I shared with the chat, okay, Abu is ready. That's great. Once you go to this link, you just click on the register here, right? And register with your emails. Okay, this is good to see. People are able to log in. Okay, we'll wait for one more minute. Yeah, we're gonna make it like very slow, right? Like, because I want you guys to try it out. So we're not going very fast. We will make it very slow so that you can match the pace.
Meanwhile, if you have any questions also, you can keep asking, but yeah.
Exactly. Yeah. Okay. I think people are able to log in. Okay. So let me log in. So once you register, you should have your email ID and password. With that, you should be able to log in. And once you log in, you should be able to reach to this kind of page, the three section page, which Kiran just shown you, right? Logged in as okay, then you can log in with any name. If you already have an existing account, you can log in with that as well. And you should be able to, like, if you go to user, you should be able to know, like, from which email ID or like
One more point in terms of registering, please register one person only with one email ID. So don't duplicate with a couple of, for same person, two email IDs is not encouraged by all the Galaxy communities. They will disable one of your ID also at some point. So it's always better to use only one ID.
Yeah, exactly. And what is the reason basically? Because these are like public instances and all the like researchers are doing the research, right? So if you have multiple accounts, that just duplicates your ID, duplicates your data and everything. So yeah, this, you need to have an idea. This is a public instance and it needs to be used carefully so that everyone can use it. And also one server, none. Exactly. So in one server, like in whenever we refer Galaxy server, it's just a different extension, right? So you have different servers like Galaxy Org, which is the kind of a main server, and then you have Galaxy EU, which is Europe server, which we are using, and then you have something like Australia one, and different region wise, right? And same also, we are soon going to have a like Indian specific Galaxy server as well. And Harpreet and Kiran is taking like great leap on that part. So we have our own server. Okay, I think everyone able to log in. Some message, I have tried to log in galaxy.org with the same email ID. Now I'm in, is there a problem? That is the thing which Tash said, right? If you have like, log in through the same email ID in another server, you need to create another account in another server, right? So you can't use basically the same login for each and every server. So you need to create a register differently in different servers. So I hope, Savannah, that's answered your question. Okay, so with this, let's begin, right? So what is our like main agenda for this exercise? So if someone asks, basically, like yesterday, Pras had shown you in command line how basically you run fast QC to do the quality check of your fast Q files, right? So we're gonna do the exactly same thing, but in Galaxy. And I'm gonna show you like how you can transfer this knowledge to the command line directly as well, right? So we're gonna see that part as well. And also we're gonna see running of the Bowtie 2, which we will align some sequences, and then we'll see run some kind of statistics with samples, right? So yeah, and if time permits, we're gonna see like how this can be done in an automated workflow manner, right? Okay, so for the first topic, we're gonna go to this link, which I'll be sharing with you as well. Okay. So the link should take you to this exercise, which is, this comes under the Galaxy training materials, you can say, and this is just an introduction. And here, the best thing about it is this is very detailed, right? Even if without like me telling you what to do, you should be able to do, because like, the Galaxy community have put a lot of effort to make it like self-explanatory. So after this session, basically you can go to this Galaxy site and go to any of the materials, and you should be able to learn by self. It should be learned by self. So yeah, so there are different topics basically. So I'm just talking one of the introduction to Galaxy analysis, right? But there are a lot of them, like as assembly, climate chemistry, ecology, whatever topic you like, right? You go into them and you should have a hands-on mock conversation. And how to know like if they are hands-on or not? So let me open this. So these are minor details, how to just navigate through the different training materials. Okay, let me. Okay, my internet is very slow. Apology for that. Okay, so here you can see, right? So just now we are seeing a short introduction to Galaxy, which is this one, which you're going to see by running FastQC. But here, see, you can see this column called hands-on. And if you go to hands-on, you should be able to reach this kind of materials where detailed explanation are given basically, right? Okay, with that, let's start with this. So we're gonna do basically, there are several things we need to do. The objective is learn to upload a file. So as Kiran already told you, we can upload through several methods, but today, like for this session, scope of this session, we're gonna see how to upload from a link. Let's say you have a FastQ link stored somewhere in a FTP or from SRA. So if you have a link, how to upload those data, and then how to use a tool. Like in our case, for today's session, we're gonna use FastQC. So how to run this tool, right? From ToolShield. And then how to visualize these results. So once you run a tool, you get some kind of output, right? So how to visualize those outputs and learn how to view histories. So you're not gonna run only one tool, right? You're gonna run multiple tools to get to your objective. And you're gonna see how all those results are like arranged in a history format basically, right? Okay, with that, okay, this is already covered by Kiran. So you can see your Galaxy address and the login details and the three different sections, right? Yeah, so this is called history. So what I just talked, this is called history and this is called ToolShield. So if you go to your Galaxy instance, see, you can see your history panel here and you can see your tools here. So these are the two main side sections, and all the other operations happen in the main panel. So this is called the main panel, right? This is where you do everything. So so let's start create a history. So suppose you are in a new Galaxy instance, and if you log in into the first time, you won't have any this kind of things, right? You should have like an empty history. So just click on the create history, new history. So it should look something like this. So if you log in for first time, it should look something like this, correct? Then what you can do here you can give a name to your history. And why this name is important? Because you wanna run several analysis, right? And you wanna run it maybe after a week, you come after a week, after a month, then you should be able to identify what you have been done, right? So this is kind of a high level kind of naming. So let's say I'll give Galaxy workshop info integrated workshop. So any name you can provide, right? Okay, so any doubts still now? You able to like make a history? Can you confirm me on chat? Or if you have any questions, please throw them out. Created history, great. Someone did it. Okay, chat supporting. That's good to see. Okay, cool. So some of you like created the history, right? So this is where basically all your data, like whatever your data import and you run some analysis, you get some outputs. So all your inputs, outputs gonna be soaked here, right? So this is where you find all of them. Okay, so let's go back to the, let's see, now you created created your first history and gave it a name. Now, the second thing is uploaded data. So like how to upload a data. So if you see here in this side, in the first panel, there's a prominent button, right, to upload your data. So click over there. If I'm going a high pace, let me know, okay? Because you need to do this simultaneously. So that I'm supposing most of you are using a single screen. So you might need to jump from one screen to another, or you can open them side by side by minimalizing. Okay, so, Okay, we can do this way, right? Like I'm gonna show you and give you like a few seconds, a few minutes to go back to your Galaxy instance and do the exact same thing which I have just shown you, right? I guess that should be a good way to go. So come to the Zoom and see what I'm currently doing basically. So you just need to create like upload data, then this should open this kind of a dialog box, right? And there are several ways to upload the data. So you can choose from your local computer. If you, let's say you have some FASTQ files in your local computer and you want to analyze them. So you can just click on this and upload the data from your local to Galaxy platform, right? Then if you have some remote files, let's say if you have a academic FTP or something like this, then you can choose this option, right? But for today, like we're going to upload from a link, which this material have already provided. See, it provided a FASTQ file basically, which is submitted in a Genodo, and we should be able to use this FASTQ file, right? So what you can do, you just copy this link and go to your upload button and then paste fetch data and click here. Don't worry, I'm gonna give you time. Click here and just start, right? So now you should see something like this green kind of button, and right away you should see your history getting populated, right? So now you don't need that dialog box. You can just see here. Okay, now it's downloading the file basically. Okay, I'm gonna pause here and can you guys try on your side just to get this file? So let me share you this FASTQ link as well in the chat. So all you need to do is grab this link, Genodo link, and go to your Galaxy, and there should be an upload data button. Click on that, and then go to the option which called paste slash fetch data. I could not create history. For creating history, all you need to do is go to this plus sign, right? So if you see on your screen, towards the right, there should be written history. And all you need to do, click on history. So then it should be creating a new one. Okay, I hope you're able to create history and answer said it's done, great. Okay, now let's talk about like, Kiran already showed you different kind of colors, right? Color codings, which you've seen in his slide. What the matter basically? Yes, like it should be empty. Like initially, if you create a history, it should be empty. Once you upload the data, then only they're gonna show up here. Initially, this is gonna be very empty, very much empty. I'm not able to upload the data. Can you come into mic and let me know what is the problem happening? Are you trying to upload from your local system or from the link?
Can you hear me?
Yes, I can hear you.
Okay. The thing is that I have clicked on upload data and then I have copied that particular link of Zendo. And then I have clicked on paste slash fetch data, but nothing is then being shown here. Yes, okay. like this. It is appearing like this only, what you are showing now.
Yeah. See, once you click on this one, it should open this dialog box, right? And then this is paste. Here you need to paste your link basically.
Okay. And then after that, what will I have to do after just pasting the link?
Just click on the start.
Okay. Yeah, it is done. Thank you.
Okay, awesome. So just with, sorry if I'm misspelling someone's name. So can you come into Mike and let me know? Sorry, just
I could not follow the first prompt because my system was low. Can you hear me now? My server was down. So from where I have to take that data?
Yeah, exactly. I can repeat the step. So all you need to do, you click on the history, right?
Yes.
Then you should see something like this, unnamed history and an empty thing.
Yes, right? Yes. Load your own data or get data from an external source. So what I have to do there?
Yeah, exactly. Did you go to upload data and then did you click on paste and fetch data?
So where from I have to take that data I'm asking that.
Okay, got it. So okay, I'm sending a link on chat, okay?
Okay. Actually, okay. I went offline, so I could not listen.
Okay. No problem. So okay, can you take this link which I shared in chat and then go to upload data and then go to this option, basically paste/fetch data and paste.
Okay. That mutant R1 first queue, right? That exactly. Data. That yeah, one only exactly. Directly I have to copy and paste.
Yes, you just need to copy and paste in this dialog box.
Okay.
Right?
Just 1 minute, okay? It's doing downloads. Okay, I'll do it.
Okay, awesome. Okay, it's doing download. Yeah.
Sangram, you can also ask them to share their screen if you want to solve it, say sometimes if you require that.
Yes, that would be great. So guys, let me know, like if you're not able to solve, like with a current thing, whatever I say, you can share your screen and let me know. So that will be very much quick. Okay, I hope all of you are able to download the data. Okay, great. Let me go to my, okay, we're gonna come into this, right? What I'm seeing, this multi-view thing, we're gonna come into this. Okay, now we have the data in our Galaxy instance, basically, under a project name. See, this history you can consider as a project name, right? Let's say you're doing a project-specific project and just give it a project name, and then underneath you can have all this data. In a simplistic term, in a computer system, you can think it of a, like a file system, right? You create a folder, which is your history. Under that, you keep all the files, basically, right? That's a simplest explanation, just to understand. Okay. So the next thing is we have our data. Now we want to run the first QC2. So where to get the first QC2? So come into this tool section and you have a nice search box. Just search for the first QC and enter. Right? So once you do this, you're gonna get into this kind of many tools, right? So just pick this tool, which calls fast QC read quality report, right? Okay. Now let's just bit understand. Okay, guys, like for now, I'm gonna showing you, then I'll give you 1 minute to try this out. Okay. So what I did, I just searched FastQC, come into the FastQC tool, and this in middle panel, you can see a lot of options, right? Okay. So these are basically the options which you give in command line. In command line, you provide some options, right? Like your input and different kind of parameter, all those things you provide in your terminal. So this is the same thing, but from a front-end perspective, right? Now it asking, sort read data from your current history. So what data you have? We have this data, so it automatically fetched, right? But let's say if you have multiple data, and you want to run this tool on only one sample, you need to choose it from a drop-down menu, right? But because right now I have only one data set, it's automatically picking it up, right? Now, so if you know any contamination files, you can add that as well. Because I don't have any contamination file right now, I don't want to give, because like, you just need to add different contamination sequences to a file and upload it from your local system, then you can provide that as well. But for now, we're gonna go with the default ones, right? The same goes with adapter list. So what are these different options? So if you've been through the FastQC tool and the documentation, so these are just additional information to improve the quality control of your FastQ files, right? You can do without them as well, but providing this will give you more accurate information. Then again, there are a lot of other specific parameters. So I'm just skipping them for this purpose. Okay, so this is one nice feature about Galaxy, right? So in each of the tools, you're gonna have an option for email notification. So what are these things? So if you're on this, because some tools gonna run for some time, right? See, like fast queues, it takes probably 5 minutes, but your alignment, all those things gonna take some 1 hour to 2 hour, right? And you don't want to sit in front of a computer and see when the job finishes, right? So what this does, like once your job finishes, basically after 1 year, one hour, it triggers an email that to your email ID, which is registered email ID, that the job you submitted is finished. So now you can look the job basically. So this is kind of a helpful, just a option, right? Okay, supposingly I have filled all the required parameters and my file is provided, and what I need to do, just execute. Okay, before that, even before executing, let's say you're just coming to a tool for the first time and you don't know any information, right? So you can read about all the information just below the execute button, right? So in each tool, you'll find this kind of information basically. I mean, in most of the tools. So what this tool does and what are the different main functions and what kind of input they take and what kind of output they take. So basically, and the citation information, all these things you get in a tool, right? So this is gonna be really helpful if you're running a tool for first time, right? Okay, with that, I'm gonna execute it. Okay, now this gives, see, two things getting executed. Okay, the color theme, I totally forgot. So whenever these things are gray, basically, it means the job is submitted, but it's in queue, right? Like some other jobs are running based on priority because lots of people are running in a single instance. So your jobs will be in a queue, right? And once they turn into basically yellow, that means your job is running, right? And once they turn into green, that means your job is finished, right? And initially this may sound a bit confusing, but once you keep on doing, this is gonna be very much clear. Mm-hmm. And there's another color code called red. Red means the job is failed, basically, right?
This color code will change automatically.
Yes, it will change automatically. Let's say for now, these jobs are queued, and once they start running, it will automatically change into yellow, right? So you don't need to It can automatically change. Okay.
Hello.
Yeah. Any questions?
So I just want to curious to know what is that tool recommendation in your window? It is showing some tool recommendation that we didn't use.
Yes. I was just gonna go through all these things. Okay. So thank you. So I'm gonna go through this. So now you saw like it turned into yellow. That means it was running. Because this is very small data, it finished very quickly, right? Now they are kind of ready. Okay, before we proceed into the output, let's look into like what are the information. So once a job is submitted, so whenever a tool runs, we call them a job, right? A job is submitted basically to a server, right? And it's gonna give you some certain information, what tool is done and how many jobs being queued, all this information, right? And what are the your input file and what they're gonna produce as an output, right? All this information. Now, this is one special thing I'm seeing from past few years, right? Initially, it was not there, but these are great new features coming day by day with Galaxy. So these tools let you know, like, what are the next set of tools you can run after FastQC? So this is a very nice feature from Galaxy EU. I'm not sure if this is present on all the servers. Kiran can give you more information on that, but
yeah. It's right now only on the Galaxy.
Okay.
It's only on the EU right now. Yeah.
Exactly. So Galaxy EU have like this kind of small features which really helps you to like leverage the platform, right? So now we just run fast QC, right? So it's just saying you the next tool you can run is multi QC, and another tool you can run is called convert compressed to uncompressed, right? So you, if you see, queue data are like compressed data, right? And you can uncompress them using this tool. And another tool is called select, basically, right? So all these tools. So if you click on one of them, before I click, let's go to the next one. So this is like kind of a nice theme, which is called like PSG comics, right? If you know following the comics, what this is a nice comics. It generates after each run. So this gives you a bit of refresh, then your analysis schedule, right? So let's say a higher job is running and you're waiting for a lot of time. you can just read through them. So these are kind of reflexing parts of the galaxy, bringing the fun into what you're doing. Okay, so what I said, like now our analysis is done. If you want to try the next tool, you can just click on this and it should automatically take you to the next tool, right? I'm not gonna run this tool. I'm just showing it for just the purpose of showing, right? This MultiQC tool is just one of my favorite. If we got time, we're gonna also see that tool as well, right? Okay, yeah, this is how you can do. See, if you see, automatically picked up the data from what you can run next, and then you can do all those things and just execute basically, right? This is it. This is about the recommendation part. Also, I have, I hope that's answered your question. What are the recommendations?
Excuse me.
No?
Hello, excuse me, I'm sorry. I got an error code 403. Mm-hmm. I was already logged in, but once I pasted the URL, it says you have to first log in. But at the same time, it says I have been logged in already.
Is it possible to share your screen and show me? I mean, is it possible to?
Yeah, sure.
Kiran, are they able to share their screen?
Yes, they should be able to share, and you don't have to stop your sharing. So you can in the top, you have an option of seeing another screen also.
Okay, let me see. Kiran, let me know once sharing her screen.
Chimisha, are you able to share the screen, Chimisha?
I am sharing. I think.
Okay, let's check.
Can you see the screen?
Yes, it is there.
Can you see the screen? Okay.
Yes, it is visible.
So now I have pasted the URL.
Okay, you took actually the wrong link. So Sangram, you have to click view options in the top, and there you will see Chamisha's screen.
Okay.
In the Zoom, in the view options, you will see your screen and also Chamisha's screen. Then you can see her screen also. But anyway, I'm seeing her screen. Meanwhile, you can try to get there. So Chamisha, you right now took a wrong link. If you see, the link starts from the HTTPS. So you have to take the link only which is pasted in the chat. So you took the complete link. No. Show that again. Yeah, you have to just copy from the HTTPS in the middle. If you see, after ref equal to HTTPS written, right? From the HTTPS, you have to take the link. Ref equal to HTTPS. Ref equal to, you should ignore. Take from the H, starting from the H, you have to take the link. Oh, okay, you resetted it. So then you have to copy again. Yeah, remove that thing before equal to. No. Okay. Okay, do one thing. Copy that link from the chat again, from where you got. Do you see ref equal to in the middle? R-E-F equal to, yeah. From there, just delete everything preceding it. Delete everything until the start. Yes, now you can say start. Okay, it still says that. Maybe you still have the wrong link. Check it once. If you have the proper link.
Okay, I can share
No, not there. There it used to be name. No, that's not. No, again you pasted complete thing. No, it will not work. You have to paste only starting from the HTTPS. Okay, that's interesting. Just a minute.
Kiran, can I add this? Can I add back as well?
Sorry?
Yeah, this is Nishin from Sri Lanka.
Yeah.
I think the problem is Chimasha has not activated the account. So once the account has been activated, yes. She can upload.
Yes. Yeah, that's correct. The behind there is a message. That's correct. Yeah. Yeah. You have to activate your account, Nishin. So you do that and then do, maybe Sangram, you can continue.
Okay. Okay, all right. So.
Okay, thank you.
Yeah.
Thank you. Kira,
hello, this is Jesu here. Hello. Hello.
Yes, Jesu.
Actually, I'm also unable to upload. I'm also unable to upload data. Can I share the screen?
Maybe is it the same thing? You need to activate your account? Is the message there for you?
No, no message is coming. That's what I'll just share. You can, my account is activated. You can just check.
Kiran, is it possible to do breakout rooms?
No, we don't have that option.
Okay.
As far as I know, it's not possible. I can check. Yeah, I can see sharing. Yeah, go on. What is the problem? Yeah, click on upload.
Meanwhile, like I think like everyone able to run analysis.
Yeah. Go on, paste the link. You need to first click on the paste and fetch data link. Not that one. Click on paste or fetch data. No. First click on upload data. And then click paste or fetch data down. Down. A bit down. Yes. And now paste the link over there. Yes. Yeah. Start. Okay. Sangram, you can continue.
Okay, great. Okay, so once you like run the first QC2, you get these two outputs, right? One of them it says like the raw data, which contains basically actually the files and everything. And this should be like a zipped file, right? Yeah. Oh, okay. So this is just a flat file with having all the information basically, right? Like your median quality, mean quality of the reads, everything, right? I hope you know like what this quality when I refer, right? I trust like statistics told. So if you open the FASTQ file, so you see the sequence, and along with the sequence, you see the basically qualities, right? So these are the qualities for each of the base. And your FASTQC2 run on top of them. Like it checks basically the quality and then it defines, right? So, and which you yesterday already seen, it also generates this HTML report, right? And the HTML report is directly visible in the main panel. So if you see here, like all the quality controls, you can see on the main panel basically. And if you want to like download this, you can do that as well, right? So all you need to do is click on the output, and there's an option to download, right? If you do that, you should be able to download. And let's say you want to share with someone, right? This link with your colleagues and everyone, you can do that as well. but I guess you will be needing some kind of permissions, which should be doable via your settings of the history, right? Okay, so some people like said like they are not able to run this analysis and it failed with the red message, right? Which is completely fine. What you can do, if you want to run it again, you don't need to do all the things again, right? You don't need to go to FastKeyTools. You can just use this button, which is called run this job again. If you do that, it should take you to the page where all the things are already mentioned. So why it might have failed, if you want to check that, why it's failed basically, you can go to this button, which says view details. And here somewhere, you should be able to see why your job failed, right? So this contains a lot of information, but it should tell you, otherwise sometime here itself, what you're seeing HTML file, here itself, you should see why the job failed, right? And based on that, you can rectify and run it again. Okay, I hope this helps. So can whoever like got a fail message, can you try to run again? Or if not, like let me know. Okay, and no.
I did run it again and it's gray. It's still gray.
You're seeing gray, right? That means the job is submitted. It's gonna take few minutes before it start running basically. So no worries, like it will turn into yellow, then green ultimately.
Can you please once more explain how can I visualize this FastQC report from the history panel?
Yeah, sure. So you can see this I button, right? So under next to each of the output or input, you can see this I button. Is that correct?
Yes, yes.
Okay, you just need to click on that one. Then you should be able to see the HTML report or the raw data. Basically.
Okay, this is the raw data, and in order to visualize the HTML file,
you just need to there should be a web page and you just need to click view data.
Okay, let me try.
Right. Okay, anyone else? I got the same error. It's like the job creating this data set has been resubmitted. I guess so can you confirm like which tool are you using, because I don't know, like I'm seeing another FastQC tool for the first time and this gave me the same error message which you guys getting. So see, there should be two tools, which called FastQC read QC report. For some reason this is currently giving the same error which you guys are getting. I can run it as well and I can show you the actual fail thing. Okay, if you go here and run it, it should give you a it basically fails. I tried a few hours before. But ultimately, you should try with this tool specifically, which says FastQC read quality reports. Can you, okay, let me zoom a bit if you guys are not able to see. Okay. So you just need to, there are two things. You need to be careful which one you are running.
Yeah, one is the latest version, which is working.
Yes, exactly. This might be an outdated version and yeah, it should be removed once you open it again. Okay, so yeah, this should is gray and it should fail in a few minutes. Okay, that's also a good negative, test. We can show you how to see error message and everything. Okay, meanwhile, I can. I hope everyone able to do this simultaneously. Okay, so I wanted to show you like how you can see. So this is the red message you're getting, right? So if you see, yeah, the error message should be visible right away, right? And this is happening because of like some old tools maybe. So how to like in such cases, how to see all the details? Like I've shown you, if you want to view details, you can actually see all the details, right? And like yesterday shown you, right? Like how to run it from command line and you can exactly see. So whenever you're submitting a job, basically in background, it's running the same set of commands which you run yesterday in your local systems, right?
Mm-hmm.
So it's basically running the FastQC, it's taking the FastQ file and it's executing, right? So this is a great learning exercise for you as well, right? Even though you are using Galaxy instance, but if you want to do it in your local system, you should be able to, extract the commands, right? And there are a lot of other details. So if some of you here are like want to run in a very automated manner from your system, you can use the APIs as well. So you can use Galaxy APIs to submit the jobs basically without doing a lot of clicking. So this is a lot of extensive options.
Hello. And
it's up to you how you want to execute the job basically. Yeah.
Hello.
Someone has asked a question.
Yeah, can you show me this where you go to this log file detail?
Okay. Yeah. So you just need to click on this view details. Under each of the output, you should be able to see this view details option.
Okay.
Then it should take you to the what are the commands being used, when it's created, all the meta information about each. So it's collecting basically a lot of meta information about each run. Right. Okay, I think this is about how to run the FastQC tool. We can go to the next tool. I hope everyone able to run this, right? Now, if you're following this link, basically from the Galaxy training, now the second option is, here it's just showing what are the things we just did. And FastQC, you should be able to see this kind of results. Let's run another tool, right? So let's say you are not satisfied with the results. For now, our file looks good because the data is good, but not most of the time the data is good. So you want to do some kind of quality trimming and everything, right? So for that, advanced tools available, like if you heard about Trim-O-Matic and Kiran shown you FastP, all those tools are available. But for now, we're gonna use a very simple tool, right? We just want to filter by quality. So if you just copy and paste this exact tool, filter by quality, you should be able to see a tool called filter by quality, right? And you need to click it over here. So here, it's already picking up the first file, which is my FastQ file. And I want to do trimming on a particular quality, right? I want to make the cutoff as, let's say, 30. So 30 should be my base cutoff. And percentage of base sequencing that must have quality equal to higher. So I want 90% of my sequences to be quality of 30 and higher, right? So now I can execute this. See, here is the explanation as well. Like I told, what are these qualities? So if you see, they've really given a nice example to explain what are the different cutoffs and where they're coming from, all these details, right? So now execute this part. So what it will generate basically, it's generating another FastQ file basically with all the removing all the reads which have less than 30 base quality, and it's giving us the filtered file, right? Now, what is this suggestion, this tool recommendation? So now this is kind of a filtered file, right? Which is a good quality. And now this can be used to run a lot of tools basically, which is you can trim them further to remove the adapter sequences and everything. You can run Bowtie to map the sequences to a genome. You can run Tuphead, another aligner, and you can do a lot of these things, right? And yes, so if you see the sequence file, it's just another FASTA file. Let's click on the view. Okay, so see, this is another one. So can you guys try this? Try filter by quality. The tool name is filter by quality. Let me post this in the chat as well. I hope this is going to be helpful to you because you can do basically, now we are showing with very small files, but you can run your actual jobs, right? Big FastQ files and everything. Let us know if you are having any difficulties. Also another thing I forgot to mention. So here now, because these are very small files, you can see the size is growing, right? It's just 10 MB for now, but as you go along, the size is gonna increase, right? And just to show you, like here, it gives a limited memory space, right? So this is something you need to take care of, like how much data you upload into this. So yeah, if you click here, it should take you to another link where it says like how much memory limit you have. So yeah, you can read about that. I hope this gives you 250 GB storage. So yeah. Kiran, is that the amount they give ideally?
No, for in the EU, you get 250 gigabytes. So that's a lot.
Ah, okay. Yeah. Okay, yes, that is all. But of course, like you can have your own Galaxy instances as well, which like if time permits or in coming Galaxy under Galaxy indexations, Kiran can take you to that as well, setting up your instances, which is part of a development in Galaxy. Okay, I hope guys can I get some message on chat, like if this is clear or you're having any difficulties running? Should I move to next one? Next tool, basically. Can I get some response? Done. Okay, Ranjan's done. It's clear still. Now, clear, yes. Okay, awesome. Whenever I see this kind of message popping up, it gives you some kind of energy, right? Okay, so this is good. Thank you, guys. Thank you for the messages. Done. Okay, now the next thing. Running another tool. So yeah, if you, so for now I'm explaining, right? But if you want to read in your own pace, you can go to this tutorial and read each of the sections. They're just explaining exact same things which I just explained. And yeah, if you click on the basically each of the files, it gives you all the meta information, right? Like let's click on this. It gives you like what are the cutups you used and what the minimum you used. And see, here is the interesting part. So we gave an input file which had this many reads, 12,480 reads, right? Now, after the trimming, it's decreased into 12,669, right? It's not many reads, but yeah, those were the reads which got trimmed. Those are kind of a low quality reads, right? So it's saying
excuse me,
111.
Excuse me, can you please explain me what is meant by reads?
Ah, okay. Sure, I can do that. So if you have ever looked into a FastQC file, they look something like this, right? So so what are these different information they have? So first thing is like starting from here to up to here, this four lines basically, we can tell it is a single read, right? And what are this information? This is the name of the read, right? So this is one read name, and this is the actual sequence which this read contains. And these are the metadata information, right? Like how much quality each base have while sequencing, right? So this constitute a single read. Likewise, this file have this many reads, 12,369 reads basically. And this can be of like a particular size. Let's say there could be 100 base pair or 150 base pair depending upon the sequencing machine, right? So if I know correctly, this one is coming from a Illumina sequencer, HiSeq, I guess. And so this might have 100 to 150 base pair in each read, basically. Is that clear?
Yes. Okay, thank you.
Okay, great. So where was I? Yeah. So basically you get to see this information basically, right? Like how many reads got removed, how many base left, all this information. And this is gonna really helpful on a later stage when you come back to the analysis, right? Okay, someone had a question. Though we are running on the same link, but reads are not same. It is okay. Ideally, okay. So this is the first read basically, which we downloaded. And this should be the same, same with everyone. So you should see this read as a first read if you open the initial file. But this one is the trimmed one. So this can be different for different people because you might have used different cutups and some reads might have removed. I was wondering the same thing. Okay, I hope like Savannah and Esther that answered your question. If not, can you come to mic and let me know what are these? The quality cutups and filter reads are different. Yeah, it's basically, it should be same, but if you're using different cutoffs, for some reason, the first read might have removed, right? So yeah. Is that answer your question, guys? Okay, great, great. Mm-hmm. You're welcome. Okay, so now the next thing, running into setting change. Exactly, this is where I was going, right? So if you, in case of fail, you can rerun it again, but also if you want to change some kind of parameters, let's say I don't want to run base quality 30, I want it to be more stringent, like I want to run in 40, base quality I want 40, right? So what I can do, I can just again go to this one and I can say I want to run 40. So the main purpose of showing this is to, you don't need to go through all the things again. You can just use the single rerun job and change the different parameters of your analysis. And you can run again, basically. Right? See, now this is gonna run, but it's gonna produce with a different result. You will see all these things gonna change now, right? Okay, let it run. So meanwhile, I can tell you like another thing. So now you're seeing these names are not very much familiar, right? Because these names are being automatically generated based on your what the input is, right? But let's say you want to make them familiarized, right? So you can just say, you can use this button, edit attribute, right? If you go here, they have a lot of information. Let's say I'll say here, a filter reads by quality 40. And let's say I want to add the name as well. So let's say I will add a mutant R underscore mutant R1 first year. I can like add this any information and I can say so now it will be renamed basically. So these are the small stuff which gonna helpful you in a long run. If you're coming back to the analysis again and again. So see now this is kind of a more readable, right? I can see this file is basically filtered on the quality of 40 basically, right? From the name itself, I can tell. Okay, now if you see the cutoff quality 40, okay. So I guess all of the reads were around 40. That's why the output is zero. No, we got everything discarded basically. Let's see how, if that was the case. If you see the web page again, the quality. Yeah, exactly. See, if you see the base quality, which is what I was saying, these are the base qualities, right? And if you see under 40, all of them are coming under 40 basically, right? That's why all of them get discarded. Right? Thank you, Pras. Yeah, Pras have made this all great arrangements. So you guys can learn this amazing session from amazing people, right? Okay, so I hope this is clear, right? The base quality and how to filter them based on different cutoffs and all those things, right? Now, let's go to something more interesting. So you have created a history, you looked into, yeah, exactly. So what I mean by history, so now we have created one history, right? Let's say today we're doing for one project and we're able to create this one and we're done it. But let's say tomorrow you're coming with a different project, right? So what you should do? You can create another project and you give it a name, project two, and you do your analysis, all the analysis you can do, right? So this is being separated from your previous project so that it's very much, what do you say? Yeah, you manage like all your files and analysis in a different history, right? So now how to navigate, like how to switch between projects to project. So if you see here, next to this plus sign where you created the project, you can see view all histories, right? So if you click on that, yeah, it should take you to this kind of view where you can see basically multiple projects which you have run previously, right? So let's say I've run previously this job. That's why all of them you can see here. Now, if you want to switch to any of the jobs, you can use this option, which you see on the switch, right? You can just click on the switch and you should be able to switch, which will take you the current history. So this will take you to the current history. Now, if you go to the home screen, instead of the new project, which is project 2, it should be back to your Galaxy One. Can you guys do this? So for the next session, we're going to do like basically a different project, right? So can you click on this one and give it a new name, any name you like? And then go to view all histories and see how this looks. We'll give you 2 minutes. Just go through them. If you have any questions, please drop a message or comment to Mike. Happy to hear. Okay, I hope everyone able to switch between projects. Can I get some response?
Excuse me, I got disconnected. Can you please once more demonstrate the method of switching and then again going to that previous history one?
Sure. So I hope you created another project, right? Using the plus button in the history?
Yes.
Then next to that, there should be a button called View All Histories. Can you click on that?
Yes, I have done that. Then
okay.
I have
so now you should be able to see multiple histories, right?
Yes, and then I have clicked on Switch to, and it's now now the current history is the previous one which we were working on. After that, but
now,
but
now it's. Yeah, the next is should be like it is switched. Now you just need to go back to the home screen. And to go into the home screen, you can just click on the Galaxy Europe icon.
Okay. Thank you.
Then if you go to home screen, you should be able to see the previous history. Okay.
Yes, it is working. Thank you.
Okay, no problem. Okay, then if you guys come into until this part and you're doing it, and so well done. So you have like done kind of introductory, right? So now you have an idea like how to move through the downloading files, uploading files, and finding a tool and running them, right? You got a very basic introduction idea. This should be your like starting point, right? To do all kind of analysis, right? So I hope this has been helpful. So next thing, like Kiran, do you want to take through them a few other things?
Yes, sure. And let's take.
Should I stop my screen?
Yes, then we can stop. Yeah.
Yeah. After you show them, like we can switch back again and I can show them.
Yeah, sure. Okay, so you had a some kind of a taste into the Galaxy hands-on. I hope you have seen how it was working with the with taking one workflow. So you used FastQC. Yesterday also you used a terminal, and of course there was a question which one to use. As I said, like it's depending on the situation. So why I say this depending on situation is because if you want to do only FastQC experiment, then there are many methods from the terminal. You can write a shell script or something. Then it's definitely on the shell script is much more easier. So you don't have to depend on any online thing. You don't need to depend on the internet. And running it locally, that would be definitely useful. But then if you want to do subsequently some other steps, then you could use the Galaxy in that way. That would be useful. And if you see, the Galaxy looks a bit easier compared to the yesterday's one, but you need to understand what kind of effort goes into the behind. So the effort, what you did yesterday, the effort goes into behind in this Galaxy. So what you have learned yesterday, that you basically doing it a bit more in a GUI, graphical user interface, or let's say better in the browser. So that's where you actually seeing those things kind of a bit in easier way. But in background, it's the same thing what goes on. Okay, I go further. I'm still continuing the same topic which I was trying to show with the COVID publications. So in the COVID research, these are the tools often used. In fact, they were three or four times in the different phases or in the steps they were used. For example, Bauti, MAFT, SPADES, and BWA. So I just, which is why I just mentioned here. So if you want to reuse the things, and if you want to reuse in different phases, having a such kind of a Galaxy structure would be helpful for you to use the tool. You don't need to install all the tools because the Galaxy has already those tools if it's a public instance. So that would be the thing. These are the tools which are not right now existing in the Galaxy, but also used in the COVID-19, which means if somebody wants to involve into the Galaxy, they can do that. So that's also kind of an option available in the Galaxy. Why I showed this one is it could be possible that you might not agree with the research or the steps what has been shown already. You will think, okay, I don't want to do in this these steps, but I want to do something different. Or maybe you want to do in a different way, only in the certain parts. So you want to take the things what you did earlier, like the steps which I showed, chem informatics, genomics, and proteomics, some of these steps you want to take, and you want to use in between some different things. That means you want to do a different method also. Then comes the idea is using the workflows. So I will try to show workflows, and also you would have a kind of demo for it after this. And probably it won't be that slow what we had the earlier session with the fast QC. So maybe when next again Sangram takes up with the workflow, maybe you can go a bit faster pace. So then we can cover a bit more other topics also. But it's not that we have some sufficient time right now. Okay. So coming to the workflows. So workflow editor looks something like this. So you have a kind, the workflow editor has basically, we extract all the things what we have done in the steps, and those steps we use in the workflow editor. So we extract from the history and then build it manually, adding configuration tools using the canvas and import using existing shared workflow also. So which means if somebody already developed a workflow, that can also be imported, and that on that you can kind of do editing things. So if you see here, kind of small parts are there, so which are connected. So one step after the other. So in this way, the workflow editor will be there. So you can actually kind of form a pipeline. So that's called basically a workflow. In the next demo, what's hands-on will be there. Sangram could show you this kind of workflow thing. So why would you want to create a workflow? So basically we want to rerun. In the fast QC, you change it to 30 to 40 and you've seen and you have rerun it. But it's not just in one step. If you have 10 or 20 steps and if you want to change in the 5 or 6 steps, so you can change in those 5 or 6 and then completely rerun the complete workflow. So in that way, workflow could be very useful. So you don't have to again create everything. You change the parameters in those 5 or 6 steps among the complete 16 or 20 steps, whatever you have in the history, in the one history, and then rerun it. You can change parameters and then again schedule it. So the jobs will be submitted. And as you've seen already, and this is completely run on the browser. So once you resubmit, you can just close the browser and go away. And then once it is done, later you can come and then check back. So you don't have to keep open your computer until that's done. Once it is done, once you open again, you can see always the status. You can also create a sub workflows, which is basically another workflow from the existing one. And you can also share workflows. So that's also a possibility with the Galaxy. And of course, these workflows are basically done as a, are kept in the publications as a kind of citations also. So this next thing is visualizations. There's a one menu button with the visualizations. This you could see probably in the next week on the Sunday. Harpreet is going to present a different topic. So there you could see more visualizations. So here you can have data types to visualize data sets. So basically you can visualize the data sets, what you have imported and generated as an output. Sequencing data, the button, like for example, visualizing in IGV tabular data or the protein data in a 3D viewer. So in the PDB website, some of you might know the PDB viewer, such a kind of 3D viewer are also available. And also some interactive environments are there. So for example, Jupyter, if you, some of you might know, it's one of the things where you can develop some code. There are interactive environments. You can actually start writing your code, and then you can run. RStudio is also there. So those things also you can use directly from the browser. So you don't have to install, have all those things. You can also directly use from the browser. Of course, at some occasions, the local version will be much faster, undoubtedly. But if it is a kind of a step which you want to run it and then leave it on the server, if you don't have a better infrastructure or a better computer, you can do that from online. Sharing the data. Sharing everything you do in Galaxy in history workflows and visualization. So directly using your Galaxy account, email address on the same instance, you can share that with a web link. Anyone, you can also say the publishing, make it accessible to everyone and the shared data also. So that's a possibility with the sharing data. Community help. There is a community help, a lot of help resources are there. One of the thing is this one, Galaxy Help. When you click on that, you will land into this area where you can ask questions. There is a lot of community curated documentation. I will put this link. You can check those links, the rest of the links available here. So you will get to understand and see those links with the chat on also in the Galaxy training community. I will also give again another set of links in the presentation. So yeah, these are the things, and you can also get to know the events about the Galaxy. So those are the steps. So Sangram will take over again, and then he will try to show another workflow, another pipeline with the example of another tool, and you will be able to see, do again another workflow.
Thank you. Yeah, so, thank you, Kiran. Yeah, I can share my screen again.
Yes.
Okay, let me know once you're able to see my screen. Kiran, is my screen visible?
Yes, your screen is visible.
Oh, okay. Okay, what is this thing? Okay.
And meanwhile, he prepares his own screen. You can ask questions if you have anything.
So what when you talk about workflows, so these workflows and pipeline are same, I guess.
Yes. They're not different. Okay. Yeah. Workflows is a kind of term used in the Galaxy, but pipeline is more about when you talk about speaking in terms of labs. So the protocol pipeline. So in that way, the term is used most in terms of the labs.
And my second question will be, can we join multiple workflow in a, maybe somebody person working in America and somebody working in India, so we can join these two workflows?
So basically, if the person who has first started it, if the person is sharing, then you can join. So unless the person who is sharing is not sharing, you will be not able to join. So once it is shared, you can definitely join. So there are many workflows people do share in publications. So you should look for some.
Thank you.
Okay. Yeah. So I'm just adding to that point. Yes. So both pipelines and workflows are the same and interchangeable terminologies, right? And yes, you can basically, if you see someone sharing a workflow in the Galaxy, or if even your colleague is like developed a workflow in Galaxy, you should be able to extend it, right? So I'm gonna show you like how you can do that. Let's say we're gonna run into this one, right? The,
the reason for asking this thing, you know, I was thinking if we are working in a group of three different labs, and one of the labs are working on transcriptomics like RNA data, one of the labs are working on genomics like gene-related data, and then one of the working with the structural bioinformatics. So okay. One of the lab is the output and input sort of thing. The person is analyzing DNA. That will be the next part, what will be the mRNA analysis. So they will be working on simultaneously with the different domain of the same problem. So they these two or three types of workflows in ultimately can be joined later on. Because basically we are working in collaboration with the different types of groups. So we have to work on single workflow and share, on whether they can work on individually, and then after that we can combine all these and get the
Exactly. So let's say like you have three workflows, different workflows, right? And I would suggest the input of one flow is the output of output of one workflow is input for the next workflow. Then it makes sense to join all three of them, right? If not, they can go separately. That would be like a standard procedure of building workflows.
Thank you.
Yeah. Okay. So here, what I'm going to see, like basically how a workflow works, right? Like as Kiran said, let's say you're running from starting a general, a typical bioinformatics analysis never completes with one tool, right? You need to run several tools to come into your objective. Let's say a simple RNA-seq pipeline. RNA-seq pipelines involves a lot of tools, right? And also the COVID pipeline, which Kiran showed you. You've seen a lot of tools, which is like one for quality control, one for mapping, then one for quantifying them, and then doing some post analysis on top of them, right? So these are a lot of tools. Likewise, in an RNA-seq pipeline, there are like several tools, like you see for quality control, FastQC, and now for mapping, which is kind of the second step, where you need basically BOTi2, and the third is like basically extracting information for that, about the alignment, which you will again do with the SAM tools. So all these different tools, right? So you don't want to sit in front of a computer and do individual tools again and again, right? Let's say you designed a protocol, then you can make them into a workflow basically, which tools can run automatically one after another without you, manual intervention basically. That is where Galaxy workflows being really helpful, right? Automating all the tasks, right? So I'm gonna show you like very quickly, keeping the time in mind. So what are these workflows? So if you go to each of the this training session, in the top overview panel, you should be able to see the data sets which can be used. And next to that, you should be able to see something called workflows, right? So now if you click on these things, it should take you to this kind of format, right? And here you should see two files, and the file should be ending with .ga. .ga, that means that it's a Galaxy workflow file, right? So now let's copy one of the links. Let's say I'll copy one of the links, link address. Let's go back. I'll go to my Galaxy server. And here, if you go to Galaxy server, there is something called workflows available, right? So you click on that, workflows. So this is kind of some things I already have, but if you want to import any of the workflows, if someone given you a GA file, or if you see some in online, you can import them, right? So if you want to create from scratch, you can create from scratch, but for now, let's import one, right? So if you click on import, and you paste the link which you just copied, right? Which should be ending with .ga file. Or if someone given you locally, you can upload that file as well, right? The .ga file and import. Once you import, you should be able to see the workflow in your workspace specifically. Okay, so this is the workflow which is part of sequence analysis, which we just uploaded, right? Now, let's say here you can run it, but before running, let's see how this looks like, which Kiran showed you the different components of it. Let's look at. So if you click on here in this link, you should be able to see all these options, right? And here is the edit button. Click on the edit. Now it should be loading the workflow. Let's see how this workflow looks. See, this is a kind of a very complex workflow and it should be draggable, right? Now all your main area is basically draggable and it comprises of different parts, right? Let's say initially it's the input, first input read, second input read, which is like forward and reverse. Then it does the pass QC step, which we just did. And then it extracts some information and then it produces a multi QC report, right? Let's say you're running for a lot of files. You can see all the report in a single multi QC report, right? And besides doing this, it can parallelly do the trimming as well. So it uses a tool called TrimGaller, which should help you to remove the sequence adapters and everything. And then after this trimming happens, it automatically connects all the output files into the bow tie, right? So you should be able to do mapping. So then after mapping, you can extract the statistics and then you can filter. And so all these things happen, right? So see, these are a lot of tools, right? And of course you can do individually by going to each of the tools by selecting from here and uploading the data. But if you have this kind of workflow, it becomes very easy to trigger all of the tools in a single go, right? That is where it comes very handy. So now let's go to our main workspace. We're going to use this one basically. And let's see how we can use this workflow. So now let's say create another history, or you might go to previous history you have created. Let's give it a name. Mapping workflow. I'll give it a name. And now, first thing we need is data, right? Let's go to this session. If you go to this session, they've shared some data. Okay. So here they have said two FASTQ files, which is one is forward, one is reverse, right? And this is a kind of a small demo file basically for quickly seeing the results. Let's upload the same way we did last time. So now my mapping is empty, mapping history. So paste. Do this, start. It should start getting the files. It should be quick. So if you guys trying now and if it's getting overwhelmed, don't worry. Like we might have another session towards the end of the all the workshops. So if you want to do in depth, we can help you on that. Can you please put in the chat as well if you can? Okay, the links, sure. See, I'm giving you this link where you should be able to, this is the tutorial which I'm just showing you now. Okay, and if you want the files to try yourself, here are the files. Okay, now you can see that we have the both the files, forward and reverse. Let's run the workflow, right? Let's go to workflow, which you just imported, and let's use this button called run analysis, right? So this is a very interesting concept about the workflows. It saves a lot of time and it makes a standardized protocol for any of the analysis you do. Okay, now you can see the same way if you run individual tools, you can see a lot of options, right? The same way you can see a lot of options here as well, but it is a bit different. Basically, you have individual sections. Let's say pass QC if you want to change any additional information. Then the next is another fast QC, and then the trim galore. Basically, these are the different tools in a single web page, basically, right? And initially, what you need to give, if everything is set, all you need to give is the input file, right? Let's say read one is out of this box. I need to choose read one, and the read two is automatically selected. Now what I need to do, everything is set. I'm gonna go with the default ones, everything. Now run the workflow. Now you should see a lot of jobs being showing here. So it's just loading, it's taking a few minutes. You should see at least more than 10 jobs would be submitted because invoking. So it just invoking the workflow. Let us wait for a few minutes. It should be quick, depending upon the availability of the instances. Meanwhile, if you have any questions until now, what I've shown you regarding workflows, you can come into mic or you can ask a question in chat. Okay. I hope all after selecting the workflow, then what needs to be done. Yeah, after selecting the workflow, you can use the input files and then trigger the workflow, right?
If for some reason during uploading the files or during this step in which invocation is being shown, if for some reasons I get disconnected from the web, then how to carry on again with this workflow?
Okay, great question. So see, now it's not using any of your local system, right? So all this is happening in a server somewhere distant, right? So once it's invocated, it should be, even if you disconnect the browser, it should be already submitted, right? So once you go back to the instance again, you should be able to see if the submission is successful. You should be able to see all of them as a submitted. Otherwise, if something happens for some reason, you should be able to see red color marks, and you can see the error message why it happened, basically, right? So in any case, you should be able to see all the information, even if you are removing or internet connection fails.
Okay.
Ranjan asked, we need to import the file. Yes, you need to import ga.ga file in order to run any workflow. Or you can create your own as well. Let me show you how to create your own. But I guess it will take more time, but let me give you a few glances.
After we going to the workflow, we are getting some options like edit something, edit, copy, download, rename. Then where can I go? Actually, I got disconnected and I missed the thing.
Okay. Here, right? You see the edit and copy, all these things?
Yeah, we need this.
Okay. So here, like if you want to edit it further, you can edit them, or if you want to copy them and then edit, you can do that. Otherwise, if you want to share this workflow which you made or you got from somewhere, you can just download it, and if you want to rename, you can rename it. So all these are like exploratory options, right? You can try with getting one of the let's say you go to one of the sessions and download one of the files from the GA and import in the Galaxy workspace and try to play with these options, right? This will give you more clarity.
No, actually, I'm trying to say that I'm going to workflow and then I'm pasting that links, two links you're giving, and then something like this is coming. Then how can I run the workflow?
I told you, right? See, this is how. You need to use this button to run the workflow. Click on run workflow button. Okay.
Okay.
Then you should be able to go to and select all the options and samples. See? Now you can run the workflow. Once you do fill in all the required options, you should be able to run the workflow. Is that,
excuse me, could you scroll down further? Okay, so there's like a lot of tools there, right? Each of the tools will load as a separate file, right?
Yes, exactly. So you will be needing a separate file, right? That is the advantage of using workflow, right? It's already connected. So let me show you one more time how the files are basically linked. So what is the meaning of workflow? It should be like one tool's output should be input of the, right? Logic. So let's say I'm generating a trimmed FASTQ file that should go to the mapping step, right? Blocks are automatically. So six jobs are submitted. Question, like how the each tool need different inputs and how they are connected. See, this is how you can connect. So I can connect, like you can simply drag, because this is someone made, this is a trusted workflow. But if you're starting to make, you need to be careful like how you're making, right? And you can see like green means like you output of this this process can be part of the next process, right? But whenever you see this kind of orange button, that means orange, or sometimes it's red, that means the output of this one can't be input of this part, right? And whoever made this workflow, they already taken care that output of this process should be the input of next process. So that's why they connected. And this is how your data flows. Let's say Trim Gallery is run and it successfully generated outputs. It should be the part of the next two processes basically. Is that answered your question?
Yes, you pressed edit to get this, right?
Exactly, yeah,
okay.
You can edit it. Otherwise, like I said, you can create your own workflow as well, right? From scratch.
Thank
you. How do you put these two sequences you have given for the analysis of this workflow? Like,
sorry.
So you have given these two sequences now. This is called read one and read two. So how to put these sequences in your workflows?
Okay. How, if you have some sequences, how to use them in this workflow, right?
Yes.
Okay. So in that case, what you can upload your sequences, right?
If you want to use the same workflow with my own sequences, then how to do that?
Yes, exactly. So let's say I have some sequences in my local system, right? You can use this upload button to upload your sequences from your local system, right? See, here is the option, choose from files from local system, and then you upload your files, then your sequences will show up here, right? And then once you go to running the analysis, you should be able to pick up all your sequences. Is that answers your question, Ashok?
Yes, thank you.
Okay, great. Okay, now you can see like it submitted 10 steps and all of them are completed basically. Where are the rest? Wait, something is wrong. Oh, okay. It's basically hidden all the other files, right? Like if you see like some files are not being shown here, that means these are the essential files which are required, might be required for your as a output of the whole workflow, right? But if you want to see like all the other files, they are hidden. You can see here, 11 files are hidden basically. If you click on the hidden button, see, these are these are kind of, you can say, intermediary files, right? Which are not really necessary for the final visualization. So I hope this kind of workflows help to you in your future analysis. So, Kiran, should I go more or are we having a limited time?
Yeah, we have time. I mean, you can go. I mean, if you want to save some more thing, we still have half an hour more.
Okay. Primarily, then we can proceed, right? So please shoot us like if you have any question relating workflows. So you can see this is 98% overall alignment rate for all the two forward and reverse files we align. And some other statistics. Yeah, basically, like I said, this workflow gives you more flexibility to use a standard protocols. So this bioinformatics works and your wet labs are no different, right? If you have a standard procedure, you publish in some kind of publications and people use those kind of protocols to replicate the analysis, right? That's how, and also, yeah, coming into replication, reproducibility purpose, if someone using a workflow, and these workflows can be really citable, right? If you share this with any publications, someone able to reproduce your workflow with their exact data, right? If they have their own data and they want to reproduce using your workflow, they should be able to do this, right? So this really helps you making the science more reproducible and interpretable, right? So, yeah. Any questions on the workflows?
So, the question is that I'm just teaching in this system, I wrote system biology and bioinformatics in Punjab University. So, if you want to set up a virtual lab for my students, so do we have a ready-made set of data sets, workflows, so that we are not as such equipped with these types of technologies? So, with this platform as such, we have a ready-made data set, ready-made workflows. So that then at least I can start and demonstrate in my classes.
So sorry, you're saying something, sir?
Yeah, there's a, like we can demonstrate with the RNA-seq pipeline. We have some of the SNP pipeline. We can have a mutational effect, something. These sort of workflows are already there. Can you show me? There we can get
I can show you some demo where you can get these files, right? Kiran, do you know any specific link like where all the workflows, because I have seen it in past, but right now I don't remember it, which is the link. But there are dedicated links where you can find a lot of publicly public contributed workflows, basically. I can show you like for a demo purpose, like few of them. Let's say you want to do RNA-seq, right? Like transcriptomic analysis. So you can go to transcriptomics and...
Yeah, exactly this one. Yeah, thank you. From where you are getting this thing?
So it's called training.galaxy.org, training materials.
Okay, great. Thank you.
No problem. Okay, so someone, are these two files are forward and reverse? Yes, exactly. So underscore one and underscore two are like forward and reverse respectively, right? So we just did a pair and data mapping here. So this is the forward, this is the reverse one. So yeah, for rest of the mapping, and you can also visualize the data, right? Like which we just sequenced. You can actually visualize this. Sorry, my system is getting hang. Give me a second, please. Kiran, can you hear me?
Yes, I can hear. Yeah. It's your visible.
I'm not able to do anything because my system memory reached the highest one.
Okay, fine. I'll take over. That's okay. So I'll take over from here.
Okay. Awesome. Thank you, Kiran. Kiran, if you can just show them the J browser thing from this link, that would be awesome. Just to see like how they can visualize their alignment files and everything.
Yeah.
Is
my
if it is possible, can you show us some workflows in cheminformatics area, if it is possible? Is there a cheminformatics workflow that also must be there?
Sure, I'm coming to that point. So basically, like as Sangram already showed, first I will complete that part which she was trying to show. One thing was the workflows. So I would say you can also do with the same thing with the JBrowse. Similarly, you can import and then run it. You can see here how it would be looking like. So the JBrowser once. So Thinum JBrowsers, once you do this, you will be able to see a kind of colors for all the differential plots. So once you go there, you will be able to see, import the same, the JBrowse, this galaxy workflow. And then you do the similar way how you did for the mapping JBrowse. Then you will be able to see the next steps. I would say you people can try this and you can ask questions. I will also show where you can ask questions if you have anything. I'll just go to next question, what you're asking, like the public workflows. So once you are in the Galaxy Europe here, so you can click on here, shared data, and then click on workflows. Then it opens up a different tab. So these are the kind of use you'll see, all the published workflows. So you can see there are many. When you say show all, there are several pages here. Here you can type in.
So when you say published workflows, this is similar like research paper publication?
Some could be publications, some could be not. So published in the sense they are open, gave as an open.
Okay. Okay.
So you can here type Cheminformatics. Probably you might find some kind of keyboard. So yeah, this could be kind of some Cheminformatic related. So there are some tags also for you, which will also in kind of with the tags also you can filter. So in that way also you can try to get the desired workflows.
Can we also connect with the owner of this workflow in the chat and follow it?
So basically here, so if you see here, this one of the workflow, protein ligand HTMD. So you can say import, and then it will be imported into my Galaxy. Then I can go into workflow, start using workflow. Then this is the one which got imported. Now it will run in your own account, not in his account. So basically you will not be able to share one workflow with two or three people in the same, all simultaneously working on the same workflow will not be, not yet possible. But then if somebody has published, you can take that workflow and you can also ask the data from that person. And then you can do the thing.
Well, it is not like we have the plagiarism sort of thing in a publication. It is not a copy paste something like that. When we're sharing and using the workflow of the other person.
Sorry, I couldn't get the question. Can you repeat it again?
Like in a plagiarism sort of thing, we are not copying the workflow of the other person to do our work. It is not like that thing. No? It's not a company. We are not copying legislation something.
No. Definitely, it is not copying. So, of course, it is expected that if you are using somewhere again after using that workflow, you are expected to cite that. So, you're expected to cite
how to cite a workflow. Is there any
so for reference? So, for example, you have this. This is a kind of complete workflow. Whoever has done, if you go to the end of the page. Citing this tutorial, you have this things.
Thank you.
So in this way you can do. If it is like this provided, then you have a kind of a better way of citing possibilities there. But probably here in the published workflows, probably for not all will be there, but most likely those workflows could have been published in some of the publication. So you need to find out that publication and then you can cite that publication.
So mostly the data set which is available with the workflows that you have to ask for the owner.
Yes. I mean, if it is available as a publish, you can already use. For using, you don't have to ask. It is already published. But if you are actually publishing yours after doing using that one, then it is you have to cite that while you're publishing. Yes.
Okay. Thank you.
Yes. And another thing is like, you have seen all these steps, of course. You have seen how to hide and other things in the workflow. So I will go back. If you have any questions, you can keep putting, but I will go back to the presentation again. So I will wait if you have any questions. Okay. So you have seen the mapping also with the Bounty and SAM tools. As I said, like you yesterday, you people used Bounty and SAM, the FastQ, and now you try to use with the Galaxy, those tools. Of course, all the tools which I, let's say, informed about the COVID workflow, those are all the tools available in most of the Galaxy public instances. I will go to next slide. So I just want to cover another part. It is just, let's say, till now you've been seeing how the workflow Galaxy is there and how to use the Galaxy. You also seen how they worked yesterday in the background. But then if you want to involve yourself into developing some tools or involve into that aspect, I just give a quick overview of it, not detailed information about that, how it would be. So yeah, this is basically how the Galaxy development work project kind of a thing will flow. It's a big picture, how the Galaxy will work. So you have a biology question, you choose tools, you install packagings with multiple methods. So I'll put this link because this image is not visible. So I'll just put this link in the chat. So yeah, the packaging. In the packaging, there are many methods: biocontainers, Docker image, Bioconda, wrappers, cargo port, all these kind of methods. They are published Plenimo, published with Plenimo, and source code deployment with biocontainers, Docker container. That's a part of deployment stage. Manipulate them instance and then flavor the Docker image with the local server or the cloud. There are several parts of the Galaxy. And there is a kind of documentation available with the training thing. And of course, the documentation is done by many communities like BioStars, Galaxy Community Logboard, and Deployment Catalog. And then comes the training part, also is available in the Galaxy Training Network. You can use the tutorials and go through the tools like what you have been right now, just check the mapping thing and also the FastQ thing. And of course, there is a support. There are channels in the GitHub, Gitter, where you can also use. So those are the other areas which are available. And like say, it's a kind of development, the complete Galaxy, how it works out. If you have any questions, I'm happy to take here.
I want to ask something like that. I heard about Docker previously, but I don't know actually how it works or what is it. Can you explain about that Docker?
So Docker is something, it is like you, for example, you're trying to develop FastQ tool. And in the Linux, let's say FastQ is dependent on some packages. It is developed in whatever language. So it is it uses some packages, but you want to have development environment in such a way that only those packages are there and not anything else. So let's say you right now wanted to develop the FastQ and then you need that environment. So if the developer, whoever have made that FastQ, can make a kind of Docker container, a Docker image, and put it in the Docker repository. And that from the Docker repository, you can just download that part. And before doing that, you should have a Docker runtime environment in your operating system. That Docker runtime environment is possible in almost all the three operating systems like Mac or Linux or Windows. Mostly in the Linux space, they work much more better, but there is possibility for the Windows as well. And once you take that image from the Docker repository, you have that environment. So then you can start continuing that project from there. The FastQ could be working. If the person who made that is made available that kind of a Docker image, then it will be working already. And from there, you can do another step. So let's assume if you want to, you developing some other tool, you can also accumulate all those tools and you can create a Docker image and then upload it to the repository. And the idea is here in the Linux, if people know about the Linux operating system, there are several tools gets installed once you have in Linux operating system. You don't want to have all the tools when you develop a certain tool. Very few tools we might require. So but with the installations, maybe there are something like 1500 to 2000 packages gets installed, but you might require for the development maybe a 50, 60 or 200 packages. So only those setup will be as a kind of compressed, filtered or let's say confined environment is called a Docker image. Yes. Any other question?
If you want to see the types of Docker images we have while we are developing this particular workflow, can we see and then decide?
Sorry, you're not audible. Can you please be a bit louder?
So So we can say there are a lot of Docker images are available in the development project maybe. So can we see and browse what sort of Docker images are available? Like if you want to use the Docker image of Gromax, so it is possible we can have this Gromax Docker image available?
If the person who is developing Gromax is made it available, then it is possible. As far as I, as of now, I'm not aware if this is available as a Docker image. I'm not able to say, but you can check the Docker repository. Also the Gromax development environment, whoever is doing that. So, yes. Any other question? Okay. Then I go back to the presentation again. A couple of slides left. So you have seen the development environment also. So for to whom is the Galaxy useful? How is the Galaxy useful for me? So if you are a life science research, also useful because the front end is completely enough to do kind of a workflows and use the tools, existing tools. So you don't need to know programming. You don't need to also know how they work. In terms of programming the technology, but you just need to know which tool you want to use. Maybe there could be multiple tools. You can think about using multiple tools and test each tool. And then whichever is better for your project or your work, you can use. So in that way, for the life science person, the person who is not from the programming background or doesn't know, also can use that. And if a person is from the computer science background or a computer scientist, they can also use, there's a lot of these, as I said, like 8,000, more than 8,000 tools, and there are many more tools coming up. And also the existing tools are not, let's say, confined to the existing stage. They have much scope to more improvements. So if anybody feel like, okay, some tools are required to be improved, so they can get involved, that's a possibility. So being a computer scientist, that's a thing. If you're a bioinformatician, of course, you can do both the things. So in that way, you can participate in the Galaxy thing, Galaxy framework. If you have actually followed my Git and Galaxy presentation in the last couple of weeks, that would also be useful. So yeah, then I want to give another quick view. Yeah.
Can you talk about what is the Galaxy framework?
Oh, well, actually, the Galaxy complete thing, okay. So the complete thing till now, what you have seen is completely called as Galaxy framework. So, I mean, Galaxy, the framework in the sense, the complete setup, what you have, that interface and the development background, how that all it, how this is able to take up all the tools to its, as a kind of bowl in the background, and then able to show up the interface in front, that itself is a kind of completely as a framework. So workflows, visualization, everything together is called as a Galaxy framework.
So these type of services are these are all paid or free, or what? If you want to use this full-fledged framework in our university, which have more than maybe right now more than 500 scholars are working.
Mm-hmm.
Is one of the biggest universities in North India.
Yeah.
So a lot of people are using these type of tools, and they are mostly from life sciences. Very few people are there from. So these sort of solutions are available for them also.
Yes, this is what actually in the present. This is what I'm trying to explain in the present slide
okay.
right now.
Okay.
So ways to use the Galaxy. You have seen the usegalaxy.eu. There are more public servers like. All this kind of use Galaxy dot things are all use Galaxy dot star, it is called. So are the instances provided by the public instances. .org is in the US, e.eu is in the European, so it's based in Germany, and .org.au is the Australian one, and .be is the Belgium one. So these are the kind of public servers which are available, and there are more public servers also from other countries in Europe. I've just listed a few of them. But the question comes, okay, if a specific research institute want, in fact, there are many research institutes or the universities have their own Galaxy, which runs internally to them. So this is not accessible outside. So this is already running, so they can maintain, they can set a kind of URL or the kind of network, everything which is runs internally and only available for the internal users. So maybe they have kind of a VPN infrastructure, or maybe they have kind of special URL, and only those people will get the account access. So not everybody will be able to create an account. So such kind of moderations can be possible. Now, let's assume you don't have an internet. Can you still use a Galaxy? Yes, it is still possible. So the complete Galaxy you can install on your local computer or a laptop, and then also use it. The Galaxy also available as a Docker image. So you can just take the Docker image of the Galaxy and then start using it. And you can also use it as a virtual machine. So you create your own virtual machine and then create your start using the Galaxy. So it is also available in that way. In terms of research institute, of course, I can talk to you, Ashok, on that. If your university is trying to set up, you can talk to me later again on that. I can probably talk on more of that. But I hope I answered your question also in this way. So that's the thing. Just a moment. Okay. I just had to refresh that one, just a minute. So yeah, this was the thing. But we're done with this. So I want to give some useful resources available or that you can use. The Galaxy Training Network, from there where you right now got all the this tutorial links, FastQ link or the mapping workflow thing, you got there. And you also have many other areas. So if you see, these are the other areas of for Galaxy for scientists and for developers also. There are many other areas you can contribute in whichever way, or also you can use those tutorials to learn yourself and educate yourself in the Galaxy. That's the one. And Galaxy Global Help, there's a GitHub channel. You can also ask questions there. We also slowly, Galaxy Indian community is trying to make another Indian specific setup also. So you can actually go here and we call it as Adda. So Galaxy Adda. So Adda pe baat kar sakte ho. You can talk all whatever you want related to the Galaxy. So that's the link. And the Galaxy project, if you want to get involved, that's part of the GitHub. When you go to the GitHub, obviously you need to know Git and other things, which I spoke in a couple of weeks before. The videos are also available. Those videos you can access from the Galaxy Project India. So if you go to galaxyproject.in, the videos we are made available. The first part is already there. Second part will also soon be coming up there. So those are the resources. Yeah. So many thanks to Galaxy community, BioCruise TMS Foundation, and thanks to you all. Of course, welcome to questions. And of course, there is another part of extension of this. Harpreet will be presenting about the more chemi-informatics workflow related, more specific to subject area on Sunday. So you can do that also. But right now you can ask more questions if you have anything.
So that was a wonderful talk and demo by Kiran and Sangram. I'm sure you would really fall in love with Galaxy. So please keep doing these exercises. You would really keep enjoying it. I'm sure you would at least finish one full length this thing with these particular exercises. So what I would probably request all of you is please take small steps ahead. Maybe there are some example files that Kiran and Sangram have shown you. If you can run through those particular things and do this as a part of your exercise and finish with a small project using Galaxy, that would be awesome. So maybe during your presentation on last day, you have to come up with a small project. Okay, so please do that. Okay. So I think if there are no questions, I think we should go ahead from yesterday's point of view, from hands-on, if you have any questions. But before which, let's thank Kiran and Sangram for the wonderful presentation. The applause, please. Yeah.
Thank you. Thank you. So actually, as part of that exercise, what Prashant is saying, you can use the JBrowse thing. So make sure that you do that. So that is there. Okay.
Yeah. So I hope you all can see my screen. Can you all see the screen? Yeah.
Yes, now your screen is visible.
Yeah, okay, good. Yeah. So, so I was just, I was just a bit surprised, why in this folder, I'm somewhere here, okay, in home test, there were some, you have copied, some of you have copied Adobe stock photos and all those kind of things, bioinformatics intern, your own files, Maybe, some of you might have used, WinSCP and simply dragged your file. So please don't do that. Okay. I don't know if it is, out of ignorance, but please. So I'm taking liberty in deleting it. So I think the... this is a folder, I believe. So what is code on code? I really don't know what is that. So I'm moving Parminder folder to workshop. Okay, moving is, it serves as two commands. One is you can rename it, or you can even move the location of that particular folder, to a different location. So here, I'm really moving to this.
You can delete this Ashok GPL and Ashok GPL by mistake. I think it is my file. I don't know why you're showing it.
Please, for heaven's sake, please don't copy these files. Some of them, might be anything. So what I'm doing is I'm copying these files to Ashok's folder, if they are Ashok's, assuming that they are this. So, and so.
Prash, should I stop the recording, or you want to?
Please stop the recording. Please stop the recording. Yeah.